One weekend, I bring home a buddy named Michael Knight. Not the guy from the 80s TV show. This guy's actual name was Michael Knight. He did not have a car that could talk. He had a Honda Civic. But Michael came to my house, and my mom was excited to have company and wanted to show out, so she cooked steak. I don't know about in your house, but my house growing up, steak night was kind of rare. The steak wasn't rare because I like my mother, but the steak night was didn't happen all that often, so I was pretty excited. And my mom cooked this nice T-bone steak, and she fills our plate up, all the fixings, and she put in front of me my A1 steak sauce, because I love me some A1. And I know for some of you naturalists, A1, putting steak sauce on a steak is just wrong, but that's okay. You can be wrong. But anyway, I look over and my buddy Michael is putting butter on his steak. And I said, "Dude, what are you doing? The butter goes on the tater. It doesn't go on the steak, man. What are you thinking?" He said, "Man, it's great. You got to try it." If you knew Michael, he talked like he talked real fast. "Man, you got to try it." I said, "Man, I don't think so. Butter does not go on steak. Butter goes on the tater." He said, "Man, I promise you, we'll never eat the difference." I said, "All right." So I tried the butter on the steak. It was great. Does anybody ever do that? Put butter on your steak?
Okay. Put butter on
me. Sorry, what was that thing? The butter on the steak was awesome. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. Normally, if I go out to eat, I'm going to still ask for the A1 on my steak. Now, I might mix the two. I might just get crazy and mix the two, right? But that you try something different with steak, when you don't get steak not much, man, that you're taking a big risk, right? Well, in this study, in some ways, I feel like we're taking a big risk. Have any of you seen the movie Hacksaw Ridge? We're going to talk about something in the next couple weeks. We're starting it tonight. Tonight will be a little bit just of an overview of some different understandings and beliefs about Christianity, Christian, and war. And then there's going to be some things that you may just flat out just disagree with. And there may be some things I talk about that I disagree with too. Okay? But what we need to do is be willing to look at the big questions. And this is a big question. Where is a Christian supposed to stand when it comes to war and fighting in war and things like that? This movie, if you haven't seen it, is a true story about a man named Desmond Doss. And I have a little clip from it just to kind of feel like in some ways it summarizes what he believes. This is, he's going before a court or whatever, court martial, fixing to try to kick him out for because he's a pacifist. He won't touch a gun. He wants to be a medic. Wants to serve. So let's watch this clip. Jaden, go ahead and go over to that, and we'll talk about it tomorrow.
Be over in a minute. You'll be home safe and sound like nothing ever happened.
Thank you.
and wishes to enter a not guilty plea.
Is that so, Private? I thought this was agreed. You wanted to enter some sort of plea bargain.
Yes, sir, but I changed my mind.
Just like that. You wish to proceed to a court martial.
Yes, sir.
On your head then, Private. Proceed.
Your Honor, Private Doss waves his morality at us like it's some kind of badge of honor. He flaunts his contempt by directly disobeying a series of direct orders from his commanding officer, when the very best of our young men are sacrificing their lives against...
You okay?
Yes, sir.
Are they still deliberating?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now you go take this in there.
I can't. It's strictly military personnel.
Well, you get one of them to take it in.
Hang on to him. They're fixing to bury him.
There is only one question that any military court need ask of the accused. Do you deny disobeying Colonel Sangston's direct orders?
What? Do you, Private?
No, sir, I don't.
Why are you contesting it, then? Why is it so important to you, given your refusal to even touch a weapon to serve in a combat unit?
Because when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, I took it personal. Everyone I knew was on fire and joined up, including me. There were two men in my hometown. Declared 4F unfit, they killed themselves because they couldn't serve. I had a job in a defense plant. I could have taken a deferment, but that ain't right. It isn't right that other men should fight and die, that I would just be sitting at home safe. I need to serve. I got the energy and the passion to serve as a medic. Right in the middle with the other guys. Know that's danger, just while everybody else is taking life, I'm gonna be saving it. With the world so set on tearing itself apart, it doesn't seem like such a bad thing to me to want to put a little bit of it back together.
Okay. Now, I will warn you, if you haven't seen the movie, spoiler alert. But considering it is a true story, and most of the information that I'm going to give you here now about Desmond Doss comes from an article from 2007, I figure it's been out there long enough that you've had time to educate yourself. But the movie is good. I will warn you, there is some language. It's less, this is sad I've got to say this, but it's less language than most war movies, okay? But there still is some. And the fight scenes are pretty intense, pretty graphic, okay? So go to watch it. I don't want you to say, Travis told us to watch this movie. I didn't want to see all that, okay? Warning you, that's there. But the idea that Desmond Doss is an interesting guy, he was a member, grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist. One of the things they show in the movie that he talked about a lot was a picture that was on his wall in his house as a kid. It was a picture that showed the Ten Commandments, and it also showed the Lord's Prayer. But on the picture also was it depicted Cain holding a club with Abel standing at his feet dead after Cain had killed Abel. He grew up in Lynchburg, Virginia, and this was something he would look at as a kid. He said, and when I looked at that picture, I came to the sixth commandment, thou shalt not kill. Mr. Doss told Larry Smith and Beyond Glory and Oral History of Medal of Honor winners, I wondered how in the world could a brother do such a thing? It put horror in my heart of just killing, and as a result, I took it personally. Desmond, if you love me, you won't kill. He was drafted in 1942 after working in a shipyard. He was given conscientious objector status, having declined to bear arms because of his religious principles. He became a medic. The only way he could adhere to the sixth commandment as well as the fourth commandment to honor the Sabbath As you know, Seventh Day Adventist Saturday is their seventh. He did the medic because he figured on the Sabbath, as we talked about this morning, as Richard talked about from Matthew, Jesus healed on the Sabbath. So he was kind of doing the same thing, so he figured that was okay as long as he was just being a medic. And then, of course, he wouldn't carry a gun. He wouldn't touch a gun. He's famous for, the movies mainly about, focuses on one battle in 1945 in Okinawa, Japan. The American soldiers were driven off a ridge, Hacksaw Ridge, and Mr. Doss stayed up there, a 400-foot high ridge. And he stayed there because there was lots of wounded soldiers. And without a weapon, he ran around and saved, according to the Medal of Honor stuff, they gave him credit for saving 75 soldiers. Although he said in an interview, it was probably closer to 50. But he got credit for the military for 75. It's an interesting story because you don't usually think of war movies talking about somebody that's, or a war story, a war hero, being someone that never picked up a weapon. If we talk about just pacifism, which we're going, I want to talk about three different categories that most Christians try to put war into before they decide whether to go into it or not. Three different ways Christians normally look at war. As I said, Desmond Doss was really influenced by Seventh-day Adventist Church and their beliefs. In 1867, after the Civil War, the Seventh-day Adventist Church took an official stance of pacifism, that no Christians should be a part of war, take a firearm, anything like that. Now, in 1972, they officially changed that. For one reason, a lot of their people were still signing up for the military and fighting in the wars. And for other reasons, they just said that it's up to the person to decide. If you feel led to go to war, then go to war. If you feel it's okay, if not, then you be pacifist. They would still encourage you, of course, to be pacifist. Of course, it's hard to trust somebody coming from a church that also encourages you to be vegetarian. So I don't know about that. The thing is, we can all agree war is a bad thing, right? We can all agree on that. War is something we don't want to have happen. We don't want it. We don't want to be a part of it. We don't want to see it. We don't want to send people to it. We don't want to go to it. War is bad all the way around. On the other hand, we also realize, because we read the Bible, and we know the Bible, that Jesus himself reminded us in Matthew 24, as he's teaching his followers, he says, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? And Jesus answered him, see that no one leads you astray. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ. And they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place. But the end is not yet, for nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of birth pains. So here Jesus is. He's telling people to look for what to look for at the end of times. He tells us there's going to be wars. There's going to be nation rising against nation. This is going to happen because we're in a sinful, broken world. But then the big question we need to look at, though, is as a Christian, where should we stand on these things? This decision is is going to affect us as far as, you know, personal beliefs. It's going to affect us as far as political beliefs. It'll affect us in a lot of ways. There's three main, I'm going to talk about three of the main Christian stances on war. Okay? The first one is activism. Activism. A person who holds activism believes that since government is ordained by God, a Christian is to support any declaration of war. Our government has access to intel and are elected to make such decisions, so we trust them to follow their lead and follow their lead. If we think about that, right away, as I talk about activism, does there anything jump in your mind that concerns you about that stance? That we would just trust the government, they have the intel, they know all the stuff, let's just follow them. Jake? Maybe something in our political system where we hear a lot of promises and we don't see them sometimes, lots of times, or most of the time. Yeah, that's the biggest thing, right? Is how do we trust the government? Do we trust their intent?
Also, the government, God will sometimes put in corrupt leaders to cause a nation to stumble and fall.
Yeah. Let's look at Romans 13. Sadly, we'll do a little flipping tonight. I know we're not normally flipping around crazy parts of the text, but we are going to look at a few different messages tonight. So, Romans chapter 13. This is a familiar passage, but this is where a passage that activists would use to defend their stance. Okay? Now, once again, activism, when you hear that word activism, I think of my first thought is people going out protesting or something. Okay, this is not that. Okay? If that's your first thought when you hear that, that's not what we're talking about here. These are people that, once again, would say, let's trust the government. They're generally good. They have our best interest in mind. Let's follow them. Romans 13. Let's look at it real quick. Verse 1, let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. Now, this is written by Paul, of course, written to the church in Rome, okay? Does anybody know who the emperor was during this time? Someone said Nero. Okay? Nero had his ups and downs. Was he writing this to people that were under an ideal government? Was it a democracy? Is that this thing? People have a lot of say? No. These were, you wasn't right at the people that had, I would think the government was probably a little bit untrustworthy then too, right? Yet he says some pretty interesting things here. Whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. He reminds us here that God has placed the authorities over us. Even the bad ones. God has placed them in authority. And so an activist would take this passage and they would say, see, we're supposed to trust the government. You're supposed to put your faith in them. It doesn't mean you don't try to elect people you agree with. It doesn't mean you don't, you're not politically active or something like that, but you would trust them. You put them in place, let them do their job. They have a job, they have all the intel, they know what that country's doing, they know what that leader's doing, they know what needs to happen. Follow them. Well, as some of you said, one of the problems is we don't have a lot of trust in our government a lot of times, right? Another thing is that both sides of a dispute will claim they have moral justification for that dispute, right? I mean, it's as simple as if two kids get in a fight. He started it. No, he started it. It ain't my fault, right? And our governments tend to do the same thing a lot of times. Well, you start. You flew your plane close to us first. Whatever. Another thing is, as we said, do we trust the leaders that are making the decisions? A lot of times our politicians have no military training whatsoever. Right? And so we're saying we want to put trust in them to lead us whether we go into wars or not. And that's a lot of faith in somebody that we don't really know if they learned it necessarily. But then when we look at this passage, have they earned it? Because God's appointed them. Once again tonight, I'll just warn you again, we're going to ask a lot of questions and not necessarily get to all the answers. Richard's here, so I have to do some kind of fill in, right? I've just got three statements that I think pretty well summarize my concerns about each of these stances, okay? And it kind of gives us ways to think about all of them, because all three of them, we can find things we agree with and we can find flaws, okay? This one, activism, we could probably say we don't necessarily agree with it very much, but most of the time when it comes down to practice, most Christians actually do that. We say, I've taught myself. Well, they know more than I do. So I guess we got to trust them. Let's fill in on your outline here. Number one, activism places trust in a government that we may tend to second guess. The next one is selectivism. And I got this out of a book written by smart people, okay? But when I put it in Microsoft Word, it told me the little red line said that's not a word. I checked my spelling and everything. I'm going to go with the smart people instead of Bill Gates, okay? He's probably smart to me. Selectivism, or it's also, we call it the just war theory. This is something in times past, I know Richard has talked about in here. It's something you may have heard before. It goes back a long time. There's lots of different views on it. I'm just going to kind of give you a little summary of how just war theory, just a line of thinking for it, okay? It holds that Christians can support or fight in some wars as long as they are waged for morally defensible cause. Self-defense would, of course, be seen as justified. Some selectivists would be okay with preventative wars when another country is clearly preparing to attack the country. So if you find out some intelligence that, Canada's fixing to attack us or something, then we could go ahead and, according to someone that holds to the just war, the selectivism, they would say, okay, let's go ahead and go up and defend ourselves. Selectivists or just war advocates also can see a crusade as necessary when conditions within a country are intolerable. When I'm talking about a crusade, I'm not talking about the crusades. We're talking about going in and, similar to when we went in to Iraq, they were going in different ways. Okay? They were going into a smaller country. A just war person might have looked at that and said, it's okay if we go in there because the bully's picking on the little guy. Let's go help him out. Okay? Selectivists can only support a war or go to war if there proves to be just intention. Those going to a war must only pursue a just peace, not revenge, territorial conquest, or ideological supremacy. How many wars do we know of where those three things are not part of the intention? Revenge, territorial conquest, or ideological supremacy. Those are a part of the wars in my lifetime, just about, right? I mean, it may not be the initial, but when we went into Iraq, we started talking about setting up democracy. Democracy may not work. Don't know. So, you have these two different ideologies that you try to, that one person thinks they have. And when you study this, when you look at these things, you really find that there's lots of different things that can get involved in this, and lots of different things that can kind of muddy up the waters. A just war person would say it must be a last resort. Limits the use of violence to genuine necessity. The violence is only when violence is needed, not just to show power, to show strength. Forbids direct intentional attacks on non-military personnel. As we've talked about some of these things, what are some things that come to mind for you where these could be issues? These could be problems to stay with all these different things.
Currently, ISIS terrorists will shoot us in hospitals and mosques, and we're not allowed to shoot back. So it's kind of unfair. It's also a store for ammo and weapons.
Yeah.
Places they don't want to go back.
They have tactics. One of the things that came to mind for me when I was studying this was some conversations I've had with Mr. Earl, who fought in Korea. And one of the things he told me is he didn't know who was the good guys and who was the bad guys. know, and more, and that's the same things we hear about in the Middle East now. You know, it's not like in the Revolutionary War days where the bad guys wore red and made for pretty easy targets, the red coats. You know, it's not like that now. It's not like that in most war. There's not a, the uniform is to conceal, not to. So to go into a war and say that you're going to try to not hit, you know, for the reasons y'all said and others, it's really difficult to do. Another thing is, you know, in the Old Testament, there's times that God gives orders that really don't match what I just told you about Joseph. 1 Samuel 15:3, when Saul was about to go in, was told to go in to kill the Amalek, said, "Now go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all they have. Do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, child and infant, ox, sheep, camel, and even the donkeys." That's going to be a hard time for a just war advocate to say that was just, yet it was coming from the source of justice. So as we look at these categories, as we look at these things and these ways to think about war, it's just really difficult to find a way that's really just level. That's it. In defense of selectivism, of just war, there is evidence of some just wars in the Bible. In 1 Samuel 23, beginning in verse 1, it says, "Now they told David, the whole of the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are robbing the threshing floors. Therefore David inquired of the Lord, 'Shall I go and attack these Philistines?' And the Lord said to David, 'Go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah.'" So here's an instance where David goes before God and wonders, is this a right kind of battle? Is this a right kind of war that I should follow? Should I go and do this? And God does tell him, "Yes, go." Another defense of selectivism, or just war, is the intuitive sense of justice within most people. If we see a bully acting, we want to defend the person being bullied. That's something that hopefully, you know, I said that, I typed that statement as I was doing this, and then I thought, you know, I don't know sometimes, because we got stories coming out about people getting robbed and beaten, no one stands up for them. But hopefully, if someone is just has it within them, if you see someone being hurt, if you see an opportunity to stand up for somebody, if you've ever been in a situation like that, there's just something that rises up in you that wants to defend that person, that wants to stand up and make things right, to not allow them to be bullied, to not allow them to be pushed around. And that's one of the things that a person that believes in just war would say. When we see someone being bullied, when we see an opportunity to stand for somebody, we take those opportunities to stand. We take those opportunities to protect those that are weaker, take those that are hurting. Of course, what could be the argument against that? Okay, yeah, well, that could be one argument for sure. Darwinism, only the strong survive.
Nowadays, if you stand up, you better be ready to pull the trigger, you know, not everybody better come.
Yeah. That's right. You got to be ready to where that standing up may go. Definitely. course, nowadays, too, you got to worry about lawsuits and things like that also. Anything else? Say, you know, this is saying that we have this intuitive sense within us to stand up when there's someone being hurt. What could an argument for the other side of that be?
Put them all the facts.
Put them all the facts, yeah. And do we want to go just by our feelings on everything? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm all for standing up when someone's getting bullied, okay, for me personally. But we want to live our lives in a way to whatever we feel we do. I don't think that's a good general attitude to take. And then the last one on defense of selectivism or just war. Although Christians are not of the world, we are in the world, and therefore we should be salt and light. There needs to be salt and light in the military, in politics, and in battle. I like that one because it's a very biblical response in a lot of ways. Now, my little statement for selectivism is this. Selectivism depends on the view and morality of each side of the conflict. Depends on the view and morality of each side of the conflict. That's one of the problems with selectivism, is we can be looking at the same conflict on different sides of it, and we can see a need to go to war that is different for the morality as the other side seeing the need to go to war. You know, those on Hitler's side, that he had given them legit reasons to go into battle. Now, we may look at them and think they were brainwashed, they're crazy, how could we ever know? Whatever. We can strongly disagree with them. But yet on their side, they think they're on the moral high ground to go into that battle. Now, the last one is that I want to talk about. Like I said, there's different categories of each of these. Okay, the just war deal, I just have a very small bit of it. But the last one is pacifism. This is what Desmond Doss held to, or mostly held to. You know, there's different levels of this one. There's a lot of pacifists that would say just being in the military, he was wrong. That's what we see most pacifists, to be honest with you. Most would say, you know, we saw a lot more in like the Vietnam War where they just run to Canada or whatever, run and hide or get, if they're wealthy, get someone to give them a way out of going. A pacifist is going to use, there is a lot of different scriptures that we use. There's a lot, especially in the teachings of Jesus. But one that's very familiar to us is Matthew 5, 38 through 40. If you would turn there real quick. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. You know, we still use that sometimes, don't we? We talk about war, we talk about all kinds of things. We talk about the justice system, things like that. I still hear Christians use that. But of course, Jesus is saying something a little different here. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you in the right cheek, turn to him the other also. If anyone sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. Now this one's a tough one. Because a lot of times when you read this scripture and you hear someone say, if someone hits you in the right cheek, turn to one, get on the left also, the other one also. It is usually followed by, yeah, but, isn't it? It's not usually a, yeah, that's right. You don't usually get a, that's right. But it's really pretty clear in this teaching. Three convictions held by most pacifists. Once again, pacifism has different levels. And I'm actually going to talk more about pacifism here in a couple weeks. But three convictions held by most of them. Jesus lived nonviolently, so we as believers should also live nonviolently. Another example for this would be in the garden when he's coming to be arrested. Peter cuts off the guy's ear. Jesus tells him to live by the sword, to die by the sword. Lots of different ones. Another one of their arguments, and here's the deal. Where would you come down on this? These pacifist arguments make you think. Okay, and I hope the whole reason I talked about the stake thing at the beginning, you start messing with someone's stake, they can get frustrated. Well, these big questions and these things I'm saying here that these pacifists believe, they should at least make us think. At least let the scripture speak to us on it. And we'll see where we come down on it, okay? But it says, another one is, since human life is a gift of God, then we as Christians should not take that gift from another. If in war we kill a person who is not a believer, we take away that chance for them to be saved. If we're fighting another Christian, we're fighting against the body of Christ. And once again, I'm going to come back to this in a couple weeks, and I'm not going to just throw out questions about it because I know I would get bombarded. So let's save those for a couple weeks, all right? And then, because of the witness of numerous nonviolent Christians, many have been won over to Christianity. We see this in Christian martyrs a lot, but there's one specific that God is working on that I want to tell you about. And it happens to be the main actor in the movie, Hacksaw Ridge. Around the time he made this movie, Hacksaw Ridge, the same guy, Andrew Barfield, is the actor. He would have called himself probably more of an atheist or agnostic before he made this movie. He made a movie around the same time called Silence. It's a Martin Scorsese movie, okay? But it's Martin Scorsese, if you don't know it, you may not have heard of him, but he's a famous director, and he's also very Catholic, okay? And he did this movie based on true stories of Jesuit priests in the 1600s in Japan, when Japan was being persecuted. So Andrew Garfield, a guy who would probably have called himself more, he definitely wouldn't have called himself a Christian. And in fact, when he was talking to Mel Gibson before he did Hacksaw Ridge, he said, now I want to make sure this isn't going to say that Christianity is the only way. And Mel said, you know, well, the main thing is just the story of this guy. We're trying to tell this story. And so as a Andrew Garfield agreed to do it with that understanding. But as he studied this guy, as he saw his life, Desmond Doss's life, read about his life, talked to people that knew him, he was amazed by this man. He was amazed by who he was and what he did. The movie Silence, the story there is a Portuguese Jesuit priest that go to Japan. They lose contact with one of their priests that had trained them. And so they go to try to find him and also just work with the Christians there. Well, they get there and the Christians are being persecuted. And the movie is pretty interesting. It's really tough to watch because the Christians, they depict the things they go through. And it actually, the ending is kind of leaves you sort of, you know, a lot more questions than you have answers. But in his preparation for that movie, Andrew Garfield went on this is through the Catholic Church, but he went on a silent retreat with some of the other actors. And during the silent retreat, they had to read the Gospels and walk through the steps of Jesus. And now, because of the testimony of Desmond Doss, and of course, reading the Gospels, he doesn't call himself a Christian still. But you can tell in his interviews more recent that God's working on him. As we look at this, once again, as we look at the Christian in war, where we should stand on it, okay? These are some really tough questions because war is such a bad thing. It is such a horrible thing to be a part of, to have. I have, of course, no idea because I've been here and happy here and any of the things that have happened. But we know that it's not a good thing. It's never a good thing. As Christians, first of all, we have to agree with the pacifist idea that it's never a good thing when life is lost. There can be some good things come out of that. The Bible tells us all things work together for the good. Matthew 5:9 reminds us, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Sons of God. We as Christians should be people in our daily life look to be peacemakers. But as we look and think about this idea of war, we have to look at the big picture. We have to look at the Bible. And sadly, there's not a place where God just says, this is how it is. So over the next couple weeks, John is going to teach next week, and then I'm going to come back and he's going to probably talk more about things like everybody will pretty much agree with. He gets an easy job. And then I'm going to come back in the week after and talk about pacifism. But I ask you to think about these things. Look up some of these scriptures. Read them. Try the butter on the steak. You may like it, you may not. Really try to understand it too. Mix it with anyone. But think about these things. Think about it a little bit. Allow yourself to think about it maybe in new ways. You know, it's dangerous. Christianity can be dangerous when we don't look at what we believe and allow ourselves to be challenged. Some of my favorite books to read, some of my favorite people to listen to are people that, well, one of my favorites is a guy that I disagree with on a lot of stuff, but he's very biblical, and everything he comes at is from the Bible, and it challenges me, because I want to look at it from the Bible, and I may look at it and interpret it, and study it different than him, but as long as we're not talking about salvation, and Jesus is the only way, then we can talk about some of these other things. And so I challenge you, if you get a chance to watch the movie, once again, remember my warnings about it, but if you get a chance to watch it, read up on Desmond Doss, a little bit about his life. We'll talk a little more about him as we go. Let's pray, and